We spoke before the hearing just briefly about what is now called the Southeast Youth Development Center. And I just wanted to make a quick comment that your team working with Perkiomen Valley School District to stand that up and provide some educational benefits to help the youth that are incarcerated there and transition in you know, modern fashion. That Dr. Russell, our superintendent, and her team, you're in good hands, and they're working hard to support you there.
And I just have to add that the Department of Education is a very strong partner in that work. So,
yeah. So we're closing the loop on that one. Second topic, nurses, and I'd just like to make sure we all talk about, whether it's Department of Health, in this case, Human Services, Health and Human Services, Department of Education, Department of Corrections, we need nurses, and we need school nurses and staff ratios that are reasonable for each of those categories of really important healthcare providers that really do provide the hands-on bedside support for our families. And I just open that for a comment. That'd be great.
Well, nurses are obviously essential to the work that goes on all across our Commonwealth in so many different settings. And we have been very willing partners in terms of supporting the ratios that have been proposed by Department of Health and other folks. And you know, we're just here to be partners in that work. I know that Department of Health in particular has proposed helping with tuition reimbursements and some of these other pieces. Again, like we are happy to partner in any way we can at the Department of Human Services. It's not necessarily, we don't necessarily have those programs to take the right lead on, but we are absolutely here to partner.
Also like to make the connection real quick that so many of the things we've talked about over the last few days all play in together. So if nurses have, you know, enormous school debt, you know, it doesn't make it easy. It doesn't incentivize them to join that workforce. And when we're talking about all the other pieces of the pie that we really need to get it systemically, you know, it's an interest across many branches of our state government. Third piece. So I guess we're getting the light's still green. We can get to pharmacy benefit managers, and I'll tell just a quick story. We closed a local independent pharmacy in West Norriton over the last year. I believe there's about 18 independent, you know, drugstores that were closed in the Pittsburgh area alone, and part of the problem is sort of this middle piece of our healthcare system, the benefit managers that oftentimes make more money than the druggists themselves who are supporting our patients, and I'm curious of what we're doing to try to manage and regulate that in Pennsylvania.
Yeah, I very much appreciate that question, Representative. Our independent pharmacists are, again, another essential component of our entire healthcare ecosystem. They are important in very populated counties like Montgomery, and they are really important in our more rural counties where you rarely see chain pharmacies opening. And so this is something that's been top of mind. I can only speak to what's being done in the Medicaid program. You know, we don't have authority in other programs, but in the Medicaid program, we've been taking a number of steps to try to stabilize the situation for independent pharmacists. Most recently, in 2024, we have amended our managed care organization agreements to require submission of unredacted contracts between pharmacy benefit managers and pharmacies when we request them. We have not been able to see those contracts at DHS. We can see the contracts that the MCO makes with the pharmacy benefit manager, but then we can't see that next level, what the pharmacy benefit manager does with an individual pharmacist. So we now have the ability to see that. The 2024 agreements also prohibit the managed care organization or their subcontracted pharmacy benefit manager from using something called effective rate payments, which is a way that these PBMs often claw money back from pharmacists, sometimes quite unexpectedly. And so those pieces, at least in the, remember, I'm just talking about Medicaid, though, but they cannot do that in our program. And then we did some other things in 2020 and 2019, which I don't have time to tell you, but I also just want to note that the Auditor General is looking at this, and we are fully cooperating with anything that the Auditor General needs in this process.
Thank you. That was my last question about whether the Attorney General was looking. I know Ohio has entered some suits.
Actually, for us, it's the Auditor General.
I'm sorry, I said Attorney General.
And we are fully cooperating with that.
Okay.